Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome back to Let's Play Dark Souls 3. Sigurd is still taking his soup nap, we're gonna move on. Man, who the hell puts their kitchen right next to a sewer entrance? That place is bullshit. This place is not. It just, as soon as you step into it, it feels old and important. And looky what we have here. Hard to tell with the lighting, but you can tell immediately from the cape and the attacks. This is not a black knight. This is a silver knight. And you know where the silver knights were stationed. I'm gonna be happy when I don't have to beat around that bush. It's interesting he drops a divine blessing. That was, that's an item that's associated. You! Oh, divine blessing is associated with, Guinevere. Okay, we want to pull him, out of line of sight of the archer. The fucking demon archers. I almost... Holy hell! Oh my god! I don't know if I'm having a flashbulb memory or some kind of nostalgic flashback. Maybe a little column A and column B. I would have actually preferred them hold off on the demon archer for later. I think maybe they played their hand a little bit too early. Because there's a moment later on where there's another one of these and you don't see him before you get a chance to get perforated by him. You just hear the sound of the arrow knocking and flying, streaking through the air. And it... I heard it and my heart sank. This vase... This is why I try to draw him away from fighting right where he was standing. The vases contain a bunch of permafrost. And they can inflict frostbite on you pretty quickly. But yeah, it's so immediate, the dread that goes down your spine when you hear that arrow. That distinctive sound of like, oh no, not these again. The Leo Ring. And... Not a mimic among them. Smough's Great Hammer. Smough's Great Hammer in the Leo Ring. Ring associated with Dragon Slayer Ornstein, one of the four knights of Gwyn, the First Lord, strengthens thrust weapon counterattacks. Ornstein was the first knight of the Sun's Eldest Born, and his cross spear is said to have pierced scales made of stone. This, I think it's slightly nerfed from Dark Souls 1, but still really good. Twisted Grey Hammer associated with Smough, the last knight to remain at his post guarding the ruined cathedral. Restore HP while attacking and carry over from Smough's past as an executioner. Not just an executioner, but a cannibal. Funny how that's omitted. You get a very real sense of history being written, not even by the victors, weirdly enough, but just the old royalty, such as Guinevere, daughter of Gwyn. This room is a big menagerie. This one's a hard one to get a look at, but with the binoculars, the architecture is kind of similar looking to Enerlondo. This is the old Iron King's throne, I think. That is the exact same picture of Nishandra from DS2 in the castle. This one, again, it's a little bit dark. That's not what I meant to do. This one, if we take a little closer look, is concept art of the Duke's archives. And this is a little hard to make it out. You can see a cloaked figure in the bottom center. And a lot of, like, frozen over architecture. So my guess is that it might be a Lay 'em Loise. Could also be the Painted World, but the Painted World, for all the snow, was not actually completely frozen like that. So my mind jumps more towards a Lay 'em Loise. There's a good kind of eclectic mix of different locales throughout the series there. That place, that room is like a menagerie, big nostalgic menagerie, gallery of stuff. Okay, so that, Soul Spear has a range. Solara. More of the slave-faced dogs. I like how, ever since Bloodborne, they've been playing with that. Like, they've just made the dogs even more erratic in how they behave. And also, they've just been playing with, like, what the dogs are composed of. Like, nothing's gonna beat the crow-headed dogs and the dog-headed crows from, the nightmare, but... These ones are a little bit more subtle in their, imagery. Like, if you get here, if you don't actually pay attention to them, you might not ever notice the thing with their faces. I think the most horrific thing is the way the jaws drop down. Like, they're hung open in agony. Oh, there's one more behind the statue. Fuck off. So happy I get to, like, do the little spear poke out from behind the shield. Oh, that reminds me, the Leo ring. I was starting to talk about it. The Leo weapon, or the Leo ring strengthens counterattacks from thrust weapons. It's an effect that was in DS1. I can't quite remember if it was in DS2. I assume it was. Memory's a little bit fuzzy on that. But yeah, counterattacks are kind of a very specific thing in Dark Souls, and Demon Souls, and Bloodborne. If you hit an enemy as they're in the middle of an attack, it's just like counter hits in Street Fighter. They will stagger a little bit longer. They'll also take, I think it's 20% extra damage. I'm always forgetting that specific number. But yeah, they'll take a bunch of increased damage if you counter hit them properly. And the Leo ring just further boosts the amount of counter hit damage they take. And it's really nice in Dark Souls 3, they actually added a new indicator, an audio cue, for when you perform a counter hit. It's that much deeper, bassier, crunchier sound. And you can hear it especially when you when you're attacking someone who's in the middle of that, like, the parry animation before you riposte them. If you don't riposte them and you just do a normal attack, you'll hear it a bunch. And that's kind of your audio cue that you're doing increased damage from a counter hit. Yeah, you're just gonna step right up that ladder. If I had time, I would have circled around and kicked him off. Like, what's his face in the Crucifixion Woods. Give him Das Boot. That Cathedral Knight kicking me off the ledge in the cathedral, that was karmic retribution for what I did to that guy. Oh, I really hope that you drop your scythe. That thing is so cool looking. The Pontiff Scythe. Can I find that from Greirat? I'm gonna have to remember. I'm gonna have to remember to get that from him. Because I know some of the other Pontiff stuff is available. Just regular knight. The curved sword. Look at that little summonable apparition. That is an NPC summon. There are two or three around here. Actually, one is another summon for you to help someone, but we don't actually want to assist that person. This is the Londor Pale Shade. The reason that we're summoning the Pale Shade is not to actually help us with the boss fight, but by summoning it, we get a gesture. There are a couple like that, one of which I think we may have missed, but oh well, it's not going to quite be 100% for all the gestures, whatever. Blackhand Goddard also has one. So we're going to go ahead and de-summon the Launder Pale Shade using the Black Separation Crystal, which you start the game off with, so you don't actually have to keep the Phantom around. And we also get Buy My Sword. Buy My Book! And we can Black Separation Crystal him away, too. Now we get their gestures, but we don't actually have to handicap the upcoming boss with phantoms. I knew one of you was around here. Oh, two! Two of you were around here. Before we do anything, there's a little drop-off you can make from up there in front of the boss door. But you want to come here first and open up this shortcut, because it makes the run from the Yorshka's church bonfire take, like, 15-20 seconds at most. And we just drop. And this is how you get to this item. It's the Ring of the Sun's Firstborn, which you're not attacking me, so I feel safe reading. Ring of the Sun's Firstborn, who inherited the light of Gwyn the First Lord, greatly boosts miracles. The Sun's Firstborn was once a god of war, until he was stripped of his stature as punishment for his foolishness. No wonder his very name has slipped from the annals of history. Yeah, that's, I think it's the identical, almost identical description to the Ring of the Sun's Firstborn from previous games. And I'm really excited to say that we learn a little bit more about that nameless firstborn of Gwyn in this game. We finally get a little bit more information about him, but that'll come later. We came back to Firelink Shrine. I have another... No, I don't. Mainly to talk to Greirat real quick.
Oh, discovering Irithyll in the Boreal Valley all in a day's work. If the tales are true, it is home to old moon-worshipping nobles and should be packed with treasure. What do you think? Shall I go and see what I can find? A fine choice. I am Greirat the Thief. What I bring back will be worthy of that name. I am Greirat the Thief. I am.
So we send Greirat out to do a second pillage. This time it's in Irithyll. The last time we sent him to the Undead Settlement. Irithyll is considerably more dangerous. But the spoils may or may not be worth it, so we send him out before we fight Pontiff. Oh shit, Maybe I'll cut that. No, I won't. It's like it has to be obvious that this is where we're gonna fight Pontiff Sulyvahn. I keep calling him that. I never ever noticed the Y before this playthrough. Sulyvahn? I don't think any character in-game ever actually pronounces his name, so I have no clue. We're gonna call him Sully, Pontiff Sully. And this is a great, extravagant arena to fight him in. And we will wind up needing a lot of this space. It seems gigantic, but... Don't you jump at me! It seems gigantic, but he can take up some of this space. Long combos that push him forward. He has these long thrust attacks. And he can close distance pretty well as well. Well, didn't quite... Oh, I didn't quite recover in time for that parry. There we go. I'm not going to completely abuse the parry against him. I just wanted to get him to this point and show off that you can parry him. But now the real fight starts, the cool part. So he now has this shadowy clone that sticks almost completely to him, like a stand. and it telegraphs what he's about to do. He hits a little bit harder, and he reaches a little bit further. And there's about a half second delay. But otherwise, the moveset from Phase 1 stays around, and he gains just a couple of new things. That kind of Moonlight Greatsword-style light wave. He has a big Crystal Soul Spear. Oh, and this. If you play this fight patiently enough, though, it's not actually that bad. Like, what I'm doing right now keeps it from getting overwhelming. Just maintain a lot of distance and wait for the telegraph from the clone. Ooh, hey. And this is what I mean. Like, we've gone back and forth across the length of this arena a few times. Suddenly, once that clone appears, this room does not seem that big. This would be a monstrously difficult fight in a tiny arena. But even with an arena this size, it's still kind of a medium level difficulty fight. Soul of Pontiff Sulyvahn. Pontiff Sully of Irithyll imprisoned a god of the old royalty in the abandoned cathedral to be fed to the devourer. He imprisoned an old god. And to be explicit, that would be an old god of Anorlando from the first cycle. And fed him to Aldrich. So Aldrich the Devourer is Aldrich the Devourer of Gods. Oh my god, what is happening? Okay. Cool. At least we got the one. This place right here. This is a big PvP hotspot. Like, it is Fight Club Central. Which is why you saw the multitude of red soapstone signs. So many of them. And look at what we have ahead of us. Oh man, I missed it so much. Oh, we're being invaded. I can't homeward bone out of here. Alright. Just to confirm, yeah, fog walled off. Okay, well, that's cool. We have a little sacred flame that we can greet our invader with. Oh, I think I hear him zoning. I gotta do this quick. Wait. No! The invasion must have failed. Oh, I really, really wanted to use that sacred flame. Yeah, it did fail. Alright. So we took a little glimpse out at what is ahead of the Pontiff's room, but we have to go back to the Firelink real quick and progress a few quests. Sure, we have our good ring on and our pyro flame, because I can't really do anything with the white hair talisman aside from use it for the sacred flame bug. That's because you can two-hand the white hair talisman, but you can't do that with the pyromancy flame.
Oh, then we're both safe and sound. Thank the gods for that. I don't like getting things so close. I might have died if it wasn't for that peculiar onion knight. But in the end, it all paid off. Take a good look. They're sure to be of some use.
Right. So the deal is, Greirat can die at that leg of his quest. The reason that we started last episode by throwing down Sigurd's armor to him in the well in the cathedral is not just to progress Sigurd's questline, it's also so that he can show up in their Irithyll sewers and save Greirat from getting killed there when you send him out for the second pillage. Patches can also save him, but it's a little more iffy.
Lord of Hollows. Ah, greetings, our lord and liege. Good tidings. Thy spouse is ready. The time is ripe to greet her. The girl awaits thee in the hidden dark moon chamber of Anamondo. So thou mayst a true monarch become. Ah, greetings, our lord and liege. Good to tie the girl. So thou.
She said it! She said it! She said it!
Till we meet again.
Cat's kind of out of the bag now. God, we're going back. Oh, what am I doing? She fucking said it. Yeah! Yeah! So, our bride, Anri, is waiting in the Dark Moon Chamber, where you fight Gwyndolin in Dark Souls 1, and she's back by the Tomb of Gwyn in the Dark Moon Chamber. In Anorlando. yeah. I mean, it gets pretty obvious with all the Dark Moon stuff leading up to this point. But you figure, like, oh, maybe the Dark Moons just, they wandered around and scattered and, you know, wandered the land. Then you get to Irithyll and it's like, this architecture is pretty familiar. But I don't remember Anorlando being in a valley. In fact, it was high on, looking over everything. But then, like, the moment you step outside of the Pontiff's room, you see the elevator that leads up to the walkway into the cathedral, where you fight Ornstein and Smo. Oh my god. Just let the nostalgia sink in. Just let it do its thing. Hey. Sniper fireballs. Oh, damn sniper priests. Am I safe in here at least? Yeah. So this would be a little bit of a shortcut. Not a terribly useful one. This is just, like, a random shortcut for shortcut's sake, that elevator hidden in the column. I'm trying to imagine where that would be useful. Kind of takes away from the shortcut porn if it doesn't have any use. Are you gonna behave? No, you're not. What is going on with the lizards today? I should totally be hitting. Ah, simple gem. Simple is an infusion that people are using a lot in PvP. It's kind of fitting that you get a simple gem right outside of the PvP hotspot in the game. Simple restores FP. And at first, it doesn't restore at a rate that sounds particularly useful. Because it restores like 1 FP every couple of seconds. It sounds like garbage. But the thing is, that's not very good for caster builds. Like, if you're running a pyromancy build, it is garbage. However, for just using weapon arts only require 1 FP to get their full benefit. You can still use weapon arts even if you have no FP left, but they're very nerfed versions. Like, they're much weaker, less effective versions of the art. But if you have just 1 FP, then you do the good version of it. So people are running with a cestus in their left hand, because the cestus is really good for parrying and it weighs almost nothing. So they're infusing that with simple. A ritual spear presented to Dark Moon Knights before Sully claim the title of Pontiff can also be used as a staff. Sorceries cast using this weapon claim the wielder's faith. So yeah, simple is a really good PvP infusion, especially if you're rocking Cestus. And even if you're two-handing a weapon, the Cestus still kind of goes on your back, so even off-handing it, or two-handing like that, you're still getting the benefit of it. You essentially never run dry of FP, even if it looks like you are, you still have that magic one focus point. Now, we're going to take the high road instead of going the lower route, because if we take the lower route, there are a couple of really tough fights, which are made all the tougher by having the priests up here snipe you with fireballs. It forces you to take the room right below where we're standing, that this hallway that we kind of came in from. Oh, wow, nothing's going to hit. Son of a bitch. Got hit with a candlestick. And you have a lot less room to kind of maneuver around, but if we fight up here and we just clear things out, it makes our lives a whole lot easier. Whoa! Didn't see you there. These things, yeah, those trees are sturdy enough to offer protection from fireballs. Oh, hello. That is a real dude. And he's a member of Covenant that we actually haven't been introduced to yet. Oh wait, he returned home. Nobody wants some of my sacred flame today. That's a shame. Nobody wants the sacred flame. I just want to honor Kotal Kahn. Guys. Oh, not priests, they're deacons. Oh, another Wish I had a drop rate that good on some of the witches stuff, the fire witch gear. But not all drop rates are created equally. The worst random drop rates of all time are forever gonna be Diablo 2 rare stuff. Like, there was stuff so rare that it kind of forced people's hands into duping, and stuff like the Stone of Jordan, this, not amazing, but still really good ring that gave you an, I think, plus one to all skills, became the basis for, like, the entire Diablo 2 economy. And it was so heavily duped that it was actually pretty fair. I miss the Stone of Jordan economy, rather than the gold one from Diablo 3. But that wasn't even, like, the worst of the shitty drop rates. There was the Wind Force Hydra Bow, which people always farmed Pindle skin. Like, they would just run farming bots on Pindle. And then there was the really rare runes. Like, I think the rarest one was Zod. And that had, I don't even know, that had, like, lottery odds of dropping. So the two guys that we just fought, One dropped the Drang Twin Spears. Those things are pretty good. I might consider rocking them for a little bit later on. Two or three of these giants are still alive. That one, yeah, when you come over to grab the ember near him. And they drop nothing worthwhile. They drop, like, dung pies and maybe large titanite. Nothing actually worth going after. Especially since we have an infinite, easy supply of large titanite. And we'll, after we're done this level, after we're done with the Anorlando, we will get some ashes that allow us to buy large titanite. So it's not even that big of a deal. Yeah, they're more tough than is worth fighting. Oh, we got some random Estus back. I think, as far as anyone can tell, there's no, it's not actually as involved as the way you got bonus humanity in DS1. It seems, as far as anyone can tell, just completely random. It doesn't seem like there's actually all that much that influences the odds that you'll get an extra Estus flask. It'll be kind of interesting down the line to see if any new data changes that, but people have been going at it and testing it pretty extensively. So if there was a discovery like that, you would kind of expect it to happen a lot quicker. Because Dark Souls 1, like, there was that hidden mechanic, and, you know, people didn't have the framework or the infrastructure to just tackle it as a community immediately. So it took a long time for, like, the really extensive testing to get done and for people to really dig in and figure out what was going on. I can't really see the heads of these statues. I wonder if they're Gwyndolin statues. But yeah, with DS3, it's so old hat at this point that the community just immediately brute forces it, essentially. Like, there is so much room for just throwing every bit of communal resources at it and just getting that data and figuring it out really quickly. It's why secrets don't remain secrets the longer you go into a franchise. Or secrets don't remain secrets for as long, I should say. Really happy that I'm only having to fight this one. If I got unlucky, I would have pulled the other one. I think just sticking to the left side of the room helped out a lot. Their aggro range is not that big. Human Drags, may have to remember to check that out. Actually, he's not aggroing me, so I do have a moment. Where it... I thought that was considered a regular, like, usable material, but not a key item. It's a Covenant item, so it... Pretty sure I just passed it. I don't see it... Oh, there it is. Proof of a duty fulfilled by the Aldrich Faithful, who patiently await the Devourer of God's return. Dregs are the heaviest thing within the human body and will sink to the lowest depths imaginable, where they become the shackles that bind this world. So they look kind of like humanity. They have that, that inner blackness. They're described as the heaviest part of the human body. And humanity was, in a previous game, described as being both warm and heavy. So human dregs appear to be some form of humanity, which would make sense given the ties with Aldrich and the Deep and the Abyss. Let's go back to that title for just a sec. The Devourer of Gods. Aldrich. Jesus. Oh, this is not good. Shit. If I would have rolled instead of blocking. Go again. One of the really nice things about Karthus Flame Arc is it lasts for 90 seconds. Wow, they can dead angle the hell out of you. Like, even if you block most of their stuff, they can just hit you at weird angles that go around your shield. It's a good chance to grab those souls. Mom, bleed. One more hit to bleed him. One more. Just two. Then again, his bleed meter probably went down a little bit. Oh, shit. Oh, good. That's not a one-hit kill. I thought it was. Wow, I thought they only did that from a distance. Like, when they're charging at you, that's usually what they do. Ooh, good, 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 good. Is he gonna do it? Oh no, it's if he survives the riposte. And he wouldn't have had enough health to do that. Ring of Favor! Formerly the Ring of Fap. Favor and Protection. Ha. Huh. Yeah, they have this cool animation that they do if they survive a riposte, where they kind of do like a little, like a dogging, dog begging. Rings symbolizing the favor of the goddess Fina, whose faithful beauty is mentioned in legend. True to the fickle nature of Fina's favor, her ring increases max HP, stamina, and maximum equip load. Good. Doesn't break when you take it off anymore. I think they made that change in DS2, which was much appreciated. Because you got that from Launchrec and you just put it on and never took it off. DS1. Archdeacon McDonnell, another one of the deacons. This is the one who went to be by Aldrich's side. We get the Aldrich Faithful Covenant from him. So that's Royce and McDonnell accounted for. And then we have Klimt, who abandoned the faith. McDonnell is likely the one responsible for corrupting it. The holy symbol of the Cathedral of the Deep and the crest of those who see beyond the fire to an age of deep waters, equipped to pledge oneself to the Aldrich Faithful Covenant. The faithful ensure that Aldrich, devourer of gods, remains undisturbed by taking the form of loyal spirits and hunting down those who would trespass the ruined cathedral. Summoning takes place automatically while online. Or while it's equipped, rather. So that's gonna do it for now. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.